Here we go again. but our next speaker is another good friend and colleague, Anna Bhushan, who's at Inuya Rokhankur, actually, but not in Rokhankur, actually a beautiful place in Paris, and also at ENS. And you know, she works in simulation and cellular automata, and also works with me on simulation networks and now in DDs. And we'll be hearing about probabilistic cellular automata.
So, thank you for invitation. First, I have to mention my co-authors on this work: Nazim Fates from INRIA and Nancy, Jean Mérès and Irène Marcovici from Paris, from CNRS and Paris 7 University. I will start with the introduction about probabilistic cellular automata, and actually first with the introduction to cellular automata. So I apologize for boring everyone that already knows that. We will in particular consider two questions that are ergodicity and fault tolerance, or resistance to noise. So what is a cellular automaton? We assume that we have a set of cells and that has some structure of a group, and that can be either finite or countable, and we will need a structure of a group to be able to define the neighborhood of our a local rule. We assume that each cell can have a finite number of states. Space is denoted by alphabet A. And cellular automaton is then defined by a finite neighborhood denoted by V, and a local function that maps the values of neighbors into a new state of a cell. So the automaton evolves in discrete time. Every cell looks at the values of its neighbors and updates to a new value at the same time.
Presumably you're assuming that V contains the identity.
It's
going to be a very strange object.
You mean that it contains its, the cell itself?
No, V is, you're adding V to the cell, K, right? So V should contain the identity, the zero element of the group.
Not necessarily, but usually it will be the case. So, we'll see that. But let's see one example. Here, the initial configuration is denoted on the bottom. And alphabet is 0, 1, blue and white cells. And then further iterations in time go up. This is called the time-space diagram. This is a very simple automaton that just does a XOR of the value of the cell and its right neighbor. So here, typically, we have zero in R set V. Motivation to consider this system. These systems, cellular automata, are very old model in theoretical computer science. They were introduced in the 50s by Ulam and von Neumann, and they became popular as one of the earliest models of natural computing, which then, I don't know, there are many other models of artificial life that continued that stream. And today they are still well studied because of their very simple description and very complex behavior they can generate. So they are used as models in for physical and biological processes. And for instance, to model propagation of cancer or development of new blood vessels in biology. And in computer science, they can be considered as a very simple model that contains the essential properties of distributed computing, which is that we can only exchange local information and we have limited memory for each site. This graph is representing a time space diagram. So here on the bottom we have initial configuration at time zero, okay. And then the time goes up. So
initial configuration means set of cells.
Initial configuration means initial values of cells. So here is a finite string of cells, but actually a snapshot of what's going on the line. Okay, so probably most of you heard about one famous Sir Automaton, which is a game of life invented by Conway in 1970. Here, typically, we don't have in the neighborhood the cell itself. So the neighborhood of a cell is Moore neighborhood that is consisting of nearest eight nearest neighbors, including diagonals. So the set of, of cells is Z2. We will denote alive cell by a black square and dead by white. The rule is very simple. Alive cell will stay alive if it's surrounded by two or three alive cells. And otherwise it dies out of isolation if less than two, or overcrowding if more than three. And if a cell is dead, it becomes alive if it has precisely three neighbors that are alive. So each individual has exactly three parents. So on the bottom, we can see one possible finite configuration that evolves after one step into this and then so any questions about model? So the rule is very simple, right? But we can have very complex behavior. So first example is called still life. So this pattern will remain the same after applying the rule. Another still life is 2x2 square. Then we can have oscillators that with different periods. Here is example of oscillator of period 2. Another one is three cells in a line that switch from horizontal to a vertical position. Okay, this is relatively simple. We have a finite set of cells that change, that stay the same or change a bit, but we can also have a bit more complex behavior, which is a finite configuration that after a certain time repeats itself, but possibly somewhere else in the space. This is in general called the spaceship, and one of the smallest spaceships or a glider. And then there was a question, can we have initial finite number of alive cells that can generate infinite number of alive cells? And there is one example. So the idea is to have some configuration that will periodically generate a glider that will move across the space. And funny story is that Conway made a challenge, and in the same year, Bill Gosper answered with what is today still the smallest such example of a glider gun. And so he earned some money. I think it was $50 at that time, which was probably much more than today. Okay, so just for fun, here is what happens. So as you can see, periodically this gun here produces a gliders that propagate in the space. Okay. So intriguing simple rule that generates quite interesting behavior. So which was not that easy to analyze. So what Wolfram tried to do is to consider elementary cell automata that have that have one-dimensional cell space, alphabet that is binary, and a neighborhood that is just the cell itself and the nearest neighbors. Okay, so how many rules we can have? Well, if you take everything into account, it's 256. But up to permutations, we can have essentially 88 different rules, and they were empirically classified by Wolfram in the 80s in four different categories. Three of them are considered as boring in some sense. Either they are, as you can see, it's not very precise. It's almost all initial configuration lead to the same uniform fixed point configuration, or to a periodically repeating configuration, or to something that is just noise. Or sometimes there is a fourth category where we can have some complex interactions that emerge, already noticed by Wolfram, but it took quite a long time to understand what that means. And so one example of each class. So here you can see that, I don't know if you can see nicely from here, I can't see anything, but you can see that the here, we cannot really say what happens. There is some kind of computation going on, but there is noise as well. So,
time is the vertical axis.
Yes, time goes up here. So let us look a little bit more carefully at this example from the fourth class. So there is some in order to be able to call this 88 automata, they are just they have numbers that just encode their local transition. So here we have 110, and binary representation is this, meaning that from the configuration of neighbors 111, we will go to 0, 110 will go to 1, etc. And It took, as I said, quite a long time to understand what it means, complex interactions. And Cook proved in 2004 that this automaton is computational universal or Turing complete, meaning that it can simulate any Turing machine on any input. So that was already conjectured by Wolfram in 85. So we saw that Game of Life also had a similar intriguing behavior. Game of Life is also computational universal, and Randall first gave a proof in 2002, and then really a construction of a universal of encoding of universal Turing machine into Game of Life server automaton in 2011. So this, and that's why there are two references. So this was just the proof that we can encode a universal Turing machine, and in 2011 there is a construction of universal Turing machine.
How do you prove that without constructing one? Usually you construct one, right? I mean, that's the
not necessarily. So what he did in 2002, he showed how to encode one Turing machine, and then just gave a list of arguments how we can extend this to get a universal Turing machine. But he didn't go through really identifying the initial condition from for Game of Life automaton that would give a universal Turing machine, which he did in 2011. So it took quite a lot of effort. It's amazing to see that people can be passionate enough to do that. So okay. That's Sarah Automata, and I'm interested in probabilistic Sarah Automata. What is the difference? The difference is in a local rule. Here, in probabilistic Sarah Automata, we allow that the local rule is not deterministic, but we have for each configuration of neighbors, we have a probability measure on the alphabet that gives the next value of the cell. The cells are still updated synchronously, and this probabilistic local rule will give us an application that is on probability measures on the configuration space. I'll use Markov chain notation, I apologize for those of you that are more used to dynamical system notation for Sarah Automata. Okay, so what would be the first question you could ask about probabilistic Sarah Automata? Well, it's a Markov chain on uncountable state space, but we can still ask ourselves there are methods to try to study ergodicity of such systems. So here by ergodicity I mean that there is a unique invariant measure and that we have convergence to it in weak sense. Well, unfortunately this question is undecidable, as shown by Tum in 90. So the way how the proof works is to do a reduction of halting of a Turing machine to ergodicity of several automata, which is a bit tricky to do because since serum automaton is distributed, meaning the construction works that with certain probability, if there are no Turing no heads around around you, and a cell becomes a head, and then make sure that it clears the space around it, so the it works on a clear tape, and then starts. Well, it has to encode, in some sense, also its initial input and the rule itself. So it's a bit complicated to do, but it's a very readable paper. So I invite you to have a look. We can still study the set of invariant measures. Nice, good news is that there is at least one. We have the set of invariant measure is convex and compact. Well, this is a very standard fact that can be shown by using the fact that the set of all measures on configuration space is compact for the weak topology that we consider. And so this leads us, we have at least one invariant measure. So there are three different cases we can have. We can have several invariant measures. We can have unique invariant measures, measure but without convergence. Or we can have ergodicity. So this was a long-standing conjecture that this case is possible. And there is one example, a very simple example of serial automata, automaton on a line with neighborhood of size 2 that has unique invariant measure but no convergence to it.
Periodic in some sense?
Yes. There are many examples that have a sort of phase transition between the first and the third case. Let me see. I'm more carefully what I mean by that. One example is what is called percolation serial automaton. So we have a set of cells that is a line, alpha, beta, 0, 1, and a neighborhood at least of size 2. And the rule is to apply a majority rule with a certain probability alpha, and with 1 minus alpha we just put 0 as a value of the cell. So each cell first costs a coin, and decides which rule it will apply, and then we get to the new configuration. First observation, all zero is, invariant measure, I mean direct measure of configuration all zero is invariant, but with using coupling arguments with percolation, we can. It is possible to prove that there is a critical value alpha star below which we have ergodicity, and after that we have several invariant measures. So the exact value for exact critical value alpha star is not known. But we have some very loose bounds for it. Yes, this is when I speak about ergodicity, it's all in, initial conditions have to converge to a unique invariant measure.
You say several invariant measures you just mean over the, do you mean for the same initial condition?
So invariant measure means that if I have a certain probability measure, I mean here in initial condition is a probability measure on configuration space. So it can be if it doesn't, if it after one iteration we have the same measure, I will call it invariant measure, but I will have ergodicity only if from all initial conditions I will converge to a unique invariant measure. Okay, so we saw that ergodicity on, in general is undecidable, but even if we restrict ourselves to the deterministic Cassara automata on a line, this is still the case, which is amazing. I mean, it's a very simple deterministic rule. A set of cells is very simple, and still the problem is undecidable. The proof goes by first establishing equivalence between ergodicity for a deterministic Cassara automata and nilpotency, which means that in the limit set we will have only one element. By limit set I mean the configurations that we will observe when time goes to infinity. And the second thing is the result of Carey that showed in 92 that nilpotency for the deterministic rules is undecidable. And this was shown by a reduction of a tiling problem of northwest deterministic tile set that was shown undecidable some time before. So it's a very complicated way to prove things, because if you really want to understand the complete proof, you have to go through different fields and try to understand different reductions from different problems. So. Yes.
So here by ergodicity you mean something else than on the previous slide?
No, it's I can see a deterministic Cassara automaton as probabilistic degenerate probabilistic Cassara automaton.
No, but by ergodicity, because do you mean when
initial condition
ergodic in the sense of ergodic theory? You mean actually converge?
Initial condition is a probability measure, and the rule is deterministic. So I can still see a. I can still, I mean, the problem of ergodicity is still well defined in that sense.
You do not mean here ergodic in the sense of dynamical systems?
No.
Okay. You really mean stability of
the yes,
map.
Because in the sense of the dynamical systems, I guess I would have, I do not need convergence to invariant margin.
Yeah. But you will have, there are no non trivial.
Yes.
Sorry, in
sense. Yeah, so not in that sense, but really in a sense of convergence. Okay, so it's not all lost, because we can look into sufficient conditions for ergodicity. And we did that using a coupling from the past arguments. Consider now a new automaton that has enlarged alphabet 0, 1, and question mark, where letters of this new alphabet can be seen as subsets of original alphabet. So 0 corresponds to a singleton 0, 1 to 1 and question mark to 0, 1. And some intuitively, we are not sure what the value of the cell is. Then we can define a new automaton, which will be a bounding automaton or envelope automaton for the original cell automaton. How it works, we will have for the configuration of neighbors Y, we will have the next we will have value 0 with the probability that is equal to the minimum of all probabilities starting for configuration of neighbors X. That is an element of Y. So Y is once again on subsets of lattice. The same for 1, and then remaining probability we will go to a question mark because we are not sure whether at the next step we'll have 0 or 1. I don't know if it's clear. Questions? And this new envelope automaton is actually a percolation serial automaton. We can use the previous result to have sufficient conditions for ergodicity. And here by critical value of alpha star, I mean critical value for ergodicity of envelope serial automaton, which will give a sufficient condition for ergodicity of original serial automaton, but of course not of course we cannot have also necessary condition because this was just approximation of aerodynamics, I mean bound of aerodynamics, and the original question is undecidable, so that would be a miracle if we could get something like that. So any questions for this part? Then, how much time do I have?
You started 5 minutes late and 15 minutes.
Okay. So, I mentioned that the second problem that we will consider is resistance to noise. So, here is one variant of this problem, which is a noise in initial configuration. So we will work still on alphabet 0, 1. Initial configuration will be a Bernoulli with will have value 1 with probability P. The question is can we, for a set of cells that is a line, construct a serial automaton or a probabilistic serial automaton such that for a value of a parameter p less than 1/2, we converge in weak sense to Dirac measure of on the configuration all 0, and if p is greater than 1/2 to all 1. Okay, so this is still an open problem.
Majority.
Hmm?
How about majority?
Excellent question. So a majority is not working. Why? Because we have some configurations that that are invariant by a majority rule. We will have with Bernoulli initial condition, we will have somewhere two consecutive zeros, two consecutive ones, and those consecutive zeros or ones will stay like that forever. So you cannot have convergence to all zero to all one. And even if you consider, so this was for trivial majority rule, okay? So it was just the value of it, the cell and nearest neighbors. But even if you consider any neighborhood of odd size, majority will not work. For even size, we do not know. So
if you allow yourself one extra bit at each size, you can do it, isn't that right?
Yes. So we'll I'll come to that. This is one candidate of one-dimensional serial automata that is conjectured to classify the density, but there are no proof techniques yet to be able to study this, before going to one extra bit of memory, let me just show you how easy the problem is if we have two dimensions. In that case, we can have the following automaton will work. For a cell, we will consider the value of itself and its north and east neighbor. And do a majority rule. So this automaton is called TUM automaton. For those of you that are familiar with TUM's work, this is automaton that is resistant to noise. That was an example, a counterexample for a positive rate conjecture. I'll skip a proof, but let me just say that this is what happens with some isolated island of noise. I'll skip that. We also have very simple examples on trees. And the problem is even more simpler on trees than it is on two dimensions. So there is another example. What's going on? Why one-dimensional case is so difficult? Because basically, what you need to be able to do is to identify signal from noise. If p is smaller than 1/2, then we will have ones that are noise in zeros. And if you have two-dimensional set of cells, we will be able to use geometry to identify what is what are the islands of noise in a sea of initial signal. But if we have this is still true if we have tree structure for the cell space, but if we have one-dimensional cell space, we can no longer identify because all the intervals have almost surely a finite size. So how to identify which is which? With extra memory, this is easy. One example that works, there are many in the literature, is to consider a traffic rule. What is a traffic rule? Consider ones as cars that move to the right, and then if there is no car, if it's zero on the right, they move one place on the right, and otherwise they stay on where they are. So this is the first on the first tape, and then we will use one bit of memory to mark whether the neighboring cells whether the neighboring cells have this, essentially the idea is whether neighboring cells have the same value or a different value. So in the case of finite cell set of cells, of course, we will not be able to perfectly classify the configurations. And now the problem is just to try to identify whether the proportion of ones was smaller or greater than 1/2. Of course, we cannot do that with without error, because dynamics is synchronous. So in one step, we can how to say that. If we can change the proportion of zeros and ones, we can make an error in some sense. And if we do not change the proportions of zeros and ones, then we cannot classify anything. So I don't know if this is sufficiently clear. But do you have still some time? Or? Okay. So what is we cannot here classify perfectly, but at least we can see the performance. We can compare performances of different serial automata. So typically, what people do in the literature is they consider the torus. Of size n, and n that is 149, I guess, to avoid the particularities of even a number of cells. And if we look at Zika Ella rule, then its performance is about 80%. There is another candidate that was proposed in this setting for classifying a finite classification of finite strings. That is a combination of majority rule and traffic. So with probability alpha, we will do a majority on neighborhood of size 3, and otherwise traffic. Why this? Because we need majority to erase errors. And we need something, some rule, that will spread errors in the space. Because as long as they stay glued, we cannot say if it's error or not. But if they get dispersed, then it's easier for a majority rule to do the correction part. So, of course, we will have to have alpha sufficiently small to be able to allow to traffic to spread zeros and ones. Okay, so traffic already defined. I'll skip that. For this serial automaton, we have an interesting result that for any choice of performance, we can come up with automaton from this class of automata by choosing alpha sufficiently smaller to have desired performance. Okay, so conjecture, if you consider now the same automaton but on a line, does it classify the density? So we conjecture that it's the case, but we are not able to prove it. So this density classification problem is somehow related to a positive rate problem. And in the sense that here we were interested in density classification problem, we were interested in erasing the noise in initial configuration, but in positive rate problem, we are trying to find an automaton that is noisy, meaning that we have usually some deterministic rule. On top of that, we have some noise that, and we, for positive rate, we ask that from any configuration of neighbors X, we have a positive probability to get any of the letters of the alphabet. And in two dimensions, the problem is easy, and the TUM serial automata is the I didn't define what we search. Okay, but the question is, can we find such a positive rate automaton that is non-ergodic? Which means that despite the noise, we will still have some information on the initial configuration. And so in two-dimensional case, TUM's rule works. But in one-dimensional case, the problem is extremely complicated. And it was an open problem for a very long time. And Peter Gaksch proposed a solution in 2001. But once again, this is not an error. The paper is extremely long, and automaton has between I think 2 to the power of 40 or two to the power of 300 states, and it's resistant to noise that is extremely small, and it's from the paper. The reviewer was not even able to say how small the error should be. So the paper appeared with another paper from the reviewer, Lawrence Gray.
Apparently he asked the editor whether
yes.
he could disclose his identity to Gaksch so they could discuss the paper, because he didn't understand certain parts.
And as a result of this discussion, it's 44 pages. It's extremely helpful because one can understand the ideas of Gaksch's proof. But still, Gray detected many errors in the initial proof, and together, this during the discussion, they were able to solve this error. So Gray is convinced that this is really an example of a non-ergodic positive rate serial automaton on one-dimensional cell space. But until now, I don't know many people that are capable of reading the Gaksch paper. So it is still a challenge to find a smaller example of an ordinary ergodic automaton that that has positive rates. And one conjecture is, I mean, one question, I don't dare to say a conjecture here, is whether the majority traffic is actually such an automaton. So empirically, results show that it might be the case, but once again, we need new proof techniques to analyze this. Okay, reference have some problems. So,
thank you. So, questions while the next speaker sets up?
Yes. So, in distributed systems, people use automata for much simpler things. Just for the first problem, just that of maintaining the integrity of the memory and atomicity and liveness, right?
Mm-hmm.
This work on incorporating coding, there's the work by Aguilera et al., and then there was also work by, I think, Frédéric Rogier did a bunch of work on that.
Mm-hmm.
Tuition just has, you know, maintenance of integrity of the data, usually under Byzantine conditions, right? The worst case conditions, not ergodic conditions.
So I don't know that, so I'm not familiar with this reference. I would say that those people do not necessarily talk, but there are some works in on voting problems that are very connected, and typically there is quorum. Yes, so there is a paper by Patrick Thiron with Florence Benazit, and I don't know, maybe some other people that have a variant of that they showed a one-dimensional serotomata with two tapes. They have a variant of it that is that between synchronized and asynchronous version that works for any graph.
Okay.
So.
Because usually the problems are not as much around the computations, more the accessibility, mm-hmm. intimacy, right? That community yeah. tends to be interested.
They're also interested in speed of convergence, and there is also lots of results in interacting particle systems that are very close. Mm-hmm. Some problems are very close to what we are studying. So there are some also results about majority role in asynchronous case.
Thank you. Thanks again.